Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Yet. Thank you to the German Council on America and to Dwayne Morris for organising this event, and also for my colleague, Christoph. I'm really looking forward to this as a free exchange of ideas and a conversation in what I think really is a landmark in European post-war history. My comments tonight really are focused around systemic change and what Brexit means, not just for the United Kingdom, but I'll say a little bit about what Brexit means for the European Union as well. And then actually I also will then just pivot to talk a little bit about US-UK relations, because I think that's germane given our audience too. So, what is Brexit? We all know it, don't we, by now, that it means Britain's exit from the European Union. But it's actually really more messy, more complex, and multi-layered. I mean, I try to communicate to my students that it's like a multiplicity of change. That it's not just Britain leaving the EU. That it's Britain having a national conversation about who the Britons are, who the British are, and actually who they want to be. And from that point, you can think of it, I guess, a little bit like an iceberg. You see the vast majority, you see the vast minority of an iceberg above the waterline. The vast majority is below the waterline. Above the waterline, in this iceberg, which is Brexit, might well be the issues of mass EU migration, and might also be issues of, for some, perhaps more on the Tory right, traditional Tories, notions of sovereignty, the diminution of parliamentary sovereignty. But there's a great deal, vast majority of issues, of factors that exist below the waterline. And below the waterline, there are a range of issues, such as a kickback against the establishment. Who are the losers in the race of globalisation? A sense of loss that the EU has become something more than originally conceived. A behemoth, a 28 member state nation which has now, for some, become a federalising project as opposed to a project of intergovernmental cooperation and trade. A sense also underneath the waterline, for some people, the referendum and Brexit is in a way an opportunity to send a message to the mainstream media, the mainstream parties, the mainstream worldview, that there are spaces and men and women outside the metropolis. So in a funny sort of way, the iceberg analogy, I think, really matters, because it's more than just immigration, mass immigration, and it's more than just parliamentary sovereignty for the Brits. I think there's a multiplicity of factors beneath the waterline which can help explain Brexit. Why did it occur? I think there's no two ways about it. You could say it occurred because David Cameron relented and gave a referendum due to the rise of UKIP and UKIP winning the last EU parliamentary election, but also the agitation on the conservative right wing for a more Eurosceptic stance. When he became leader of the Conservative Party and leader of Her Majesty's opposition in 2005, he did style himself, David Cameron this is, as a Eurosceptic. And as time has gone on, especially his partnership with the most pro-European Liberal Democrats between 2010 and 2015, mutterings and great concern within the Conservative Party really kind of reached a crescendo about to what extent is this Conservative meaningfully a Conservative? If he was, then why aren't we talking more about Euroscepticism? Why aren't we talking about, you know, having a national conversation of leaving? But the catalyst, uncertainly, you know, without doubt, certainly, was the rise of Nigel Farage and UKIP to effectively, professionally link together dissatisfied traditional Labour Party working class voters and right-wing inclined voters who are concerned about immigration, and also, I think, more libertarian focused economic issues. So those are almost like sort of libertarian economics, anti-immigration, and then the pivot about 3 years ago towards the Northern English working class, trying to communicate to them in a less politically correct, more plain-spoken way, a narrative of about patriotism and about push against the chattering classes of Brussels and London. So that triangulation of UKIP, I think, really, and its success in local elections, not in the national election in 2015 when they won one solitary seat, even though they accrued 3.88 million votes. They accrued more votes than the Scottish National Party, who received over 50 seats. So purely in the popular vote, UKIP are the third party in the United Kingdom, even though they have one MP, well, they have one MP really, because he just resigned. But the point of the matter is, we are where we are because of pressure from the Conservative Party right wing against a perceived liberal, David Cameron, and the rise of UKIP. And so, like many people, I thought the result would be very much one where the Remain camp would win. The Kingdom really committed to the European project, to use Stephen George's phrase, the awkward partner. That has now come to the fore. But I think there is one of a structural, systemic nature which is greatly concerning for people who believe in the EU, which is this notion of, will this be a viral problem? Will this Brexit lead to a Grexit, or goodness me, a Frexit? Have you set a precedent now? Is the ball in motion? And I think really the nature of these negotiations and how this divorce is played out will either push towards a notion of the exits from the EU are possible, manageable. If that is the case, then I think they are possible for other countries. So I guess in a way it's in the EU's interest to make this as uncomfortable and as bumpy for the United Kingdom, to send a message to other Eurosceptic forces that this is not good. All right, Britain's just about managed it, but they're going to be worse off for it. So I think really this notion of a viral Brexit, that I think is a very pertinent question. Also the one of a shrinking single market. So Britain is 65.5 million people. By my maths, and I'm not a mathematician, it's about 12.8%, call it 13%, of the single market. That's not huge, but it's a significant minority. And also, broadly speaking, they're a relatively wealthy marketplace as well. But I think also there are other aspects. And forgive me for saying this, because I'm an Englishman in San Francisco, but I think the United Kingdom does matter. The United Kingdom is, all states are not equal. The United Kingdom is a great power. It's a great power militarily. It has a permanent five member of the UN Security Council. It is a nuclear power, one of only two in Europe. It is the keystone NATO power in Europe. France isn't. You can't really call France the keystone NATO power, when seeing it's been absent from NATO from 1966 to 2009. So a great power does bow out, both diplomatically, militarily, in terms of humanitarian issues. And I think that's huge systemic change for the EU. I think it makes the EU weaker, and in one sense more significant in terms of geopolitics. That's why those of us who believe in intergovernmental relationships need to carry on working closely between our allies and our partners across the English Channel on issues like people trafficking, to reduce that heinous crime, to reduce the dreadful threat of Islamic fundamentalist terrorism, which is the clear and present threat for Western European states. The clear and present threat for civil peace and liberal order in Europe. And we must address that directly. And we must never, because of any pressure of political correctness, or the fact that we're in the United States and the threat is not the same here, we must address that threat. We've just had this horrific tragedy in my nation's capital last week, week before last. We've had it in Brussels. We've had it at the Bataclan. We've had it throughout Europe. and needs to be addressed. So Britain must continue its commitment to liberal democracy, human rights, and defeating Islamic fundamentalist terrorism. And for that, we must continue to work in partnership with our European cousins. And of course, I think the other issue is one of German hegemony. Germany is the largest and the most influential economic and social, is the largest economic and social power within Germany. 81 billion dollars, $3.73 trillion GDP in 2013. 81 million people. 81 million people, when you think of that, Germany is the lead player in Europe. And my colleagues in Bavaria, and I teach with, I have connections with political organizations in Bavaria, and I have colleagues who I teach with at Hull, who are German citizens. They never wanted this. They did not, they were very, felt very much that Germany would not want to be the sole hegemon. And of course, France is a significant power in Europe, very much so too. But I think even post-Brexit, the nature of United Kingdom's relationship with Germany has to be a clear, honest, and close one, for all the reasons I've set out. Germany does not want to go it alone. In terms of the United Kingdom, very quickly, then I'll pretty much stop. There is the uncertainty principle. The strongest argument for remaining in the EU is one of huge economic and political uncertainty. We've not faced this level of uncertainty in the post-war era. This, if you wanted to place the loss, if you wanted to grade the loss, you'd have to say it's Labour's loss, the Labour Party's lost. It's the Labour Party's loss because the Labour Party has been, since the mid-1990s, an extraordinarily pro-European, if not federalist, but a pro-European organisation that has built very strong ties amongst the progressive and centre-left movements throughout Europe, especially Western Europe. And for them, I think this really is a nightmare. I think it's a nightmare because it flags up something that I've called in an essay I've got coming out this summer, the values gap. The Labour Party has lost its huge amounts of its blue-collar working class. It's lost them since the Blair years onwards. It's lost them because they've ceased to have sufficient MPs, they've ceased to have sufficient belief in, they've ceased to have sufficient policies that paint a patriotic Labour view of Britain, something that binds people together more than just feminism, abortion, gay rights, and human rights. Now, for an awful lot of people in the Labour Party, feminism, abortion, gay rights, and human rights are why they're in the Labour Party. And that's absolutely fine. But that's the problem that you might want to call the cosmopolitans versus the conservatives. Not as in the Conservative Party, the conservatives on the left, the small C conservatives on the left. Those issues are not why they're in the Labour Party. They're not in the Labour Party. Actually, for some people, their issues and this rise of political correctness to go along with those issues are why they perhaps don't want to align themselves with the Labour Party. So this is Labour's loss. And it's a loss because it's a values gap. They've not lost these people because of Brexit. Brexit is the instrument through which an awful lot of Labour-inclined citizens have chosen to communicate their worldview, not just to the British establishment, but also to the Labour Party. And it's not just the fact that the Labour Party has an immensely left-wing leader in Jeremy Corbyn. Corbyn is the straw that has broken the camel's back for many of these citizens, because he's obviously anti-nuclear, he's anti-NATO, he's hugely sceptical of the United States of America. You know, he doesn't really say much about the economy. His big things are about refugees and immigration and what have you. Fine. Absolutely fine. There's a space on the left for that, absolutely. A pacifistic internationalism. A very hostile towards Israel, pro-Palestinian internationalism. There's space on the left for that. I personally wouldn't occupy it myself. But he's not the reason why an awful lot of small-c conservative Labourites have stopped voting. He's just a symptom of it. It's not the cause. The cause is a values gap. The drift. Labour's lost. In terms of US-UK, Well, there'll always be an England, someone once sang, an England strong and free, someone once sang. But what it will be in a meaningful sense, in a geopolitical sense, I'm not quite sure. I think what it has to do, as well as keep these allies and partnerships going through this difficult divorce from the European Union, is to do two things. It has to reassert its connections with the Commonwealth, with the emerging markets, especially with India and the subcontinent, but it also has to make a mother of all trade deals with the United States. Now, is that possible? How long will it take? Will it be in UK's interest? I've no idea. I've no crystal ball. I've no idea. What about President Donald J. Trump? What about the fact that he seems neither to be a conservative or a president who is cut from any particularly obvious ideological cloth? He seems to be idiosyncratic and one-off. So it's difficult to see how this is going to move forward. I think perhaps he views the United Kingdom in a warmer way than President Obama viewed the United Kingdom. I think President Obama was not a natural Anglophile, I don't think. But who knows how this will play out. But it's in the United Kingdom's interest to get a very good deal with the United States, and to focus on especially India and the subcontinent in terms of trade. For me personally, I think on both movements, in the United States and in Britain, you're seeing a rise of a type of populism which you might just want to phrase kick the establishment. I think the centre-left in America is in much better shape than the centre-left or the left in the United Kingdom, as I've just set out. But I think I would characterise it really, it's the progressive sphere. I think there's a fear now that there's a fracturing, political fracturing based upon a sense of economic loss and a sense of aspirational loss that has led an awful lot of people to look, if not to the opposing party of their class and the opposing party of their parents, then certainly maybe temporarily to a candidate who is going to promise something, promise a degree of change, even if that change is really kind of wild. Really kind of wild change. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your time. I'll be very glad to take your questions.
Yes. Thank you very much, Matt, for your introduction. And first of all, thank you to Duane Morris and the San Francisco Warburg Chapter to be our host today. I'm a lawyer. That's why my presentation is much more focused on the legal issues of Brexit. So it is divided in four parts. I will say something in general about the Brexit, and then I will tackle the legal issues. I will try an outlook, and finally some words about the Frankfurt perspective, which is my hometown, and it is the financial center of continental Europe. There are always some victim identified, some victims of the Brexit, and matters spoken about them. 3 million European Union citizens living in the United Kingdom, and now they feel treated like aliens, and there are millions of UK citizens who now think about double citizenship because they would like to remain European citizens. So I think today Ireland is a favorite for double citizenship because it's easy to become an Irish passport for English people. But fortunately, I think there are also some signs of hope. As you may know, the Germans and Dutch have not been such close friends, even though I know, Jed, you are Dutch, but that's a tradition. But after the outcome of the Dutch elections last month, which was a very strong stand against populism, they felt much closer. And 10 days ago, we had general elections in one of the German federal states, Saarland, and only 6% of the people voted for right-wing populists. Only 6%, that means 94% of the people voted against it. This was quite impressive. Yeah, as you all know, Theresa May started the Brexit process 10 days ago, and her choice is clear, a hard Brexit. What does it mean, a hard Brexit? After 43 years of membership of the European Union, 52% of the people in the United Kingdom voted against or voted for leaving the European Union. But what is quite interesting is that three regions of the United Kingdom voted for remain.
The City of London, 60%. Scotland, 62%. And Northern Ireland, 56%.
So it was the countryside, one can say, who voted against the European Union. And it was not Northern Ireland and not Scotland. And perhaps this is much more important, two of these regions have the right to self-government, Scotland and Northern Ireland. And that's why the Scottish First Minister, Nicola Sturgeon, already asked the British government for its acceptance of a second independence referendum. So it is thinkable that the Brexit will lead to the end of the United Kingdom. This is really interesting. And for Northern Ireland, it's even more complicated.
Because this will be the border of the European Union, a border between Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland.
So we'll see. This will happen. The question is only when it will happen. Matt already spoke about Article 50. Article 50 of the European Union Treaty is quite a new article. Since 2009, this option existed, the possibility to withdraw from the European Union. Before 2009, this was not possible. It was not written in the treaties. Theresa May triggered Article 50 10 days ago, and now the European Union and the UK have 2 years to negotiate their future relationship. That means by March 2019, there must be a final decision on the exit conditions. And the European Commission has already put a bill on the table, 60 million euros, 65 million, billion euros, $65 billion. And you should keep in mind that this decision must not only be accepted by the British Parliament, which is now decided by the High Court, but also by the parliaments of the 27 remaining member states. So, if all this fails, it will be the hardest Brexit thinkable. And there exists already a code in Brussels and London for this cliff edge. As you all know, there exists no blueprint for the Brexit. The only territory that ever exited from the European Union was Greenland some 30 years ago, and it was a Danish territory with 50,000 inhabitants. So there exists some templates about the future relations between the United Kingdom and the European Union. Two good examples are
Norway and Switzerland.
Both countries are not members of the European Union, but they are integrated into the internal market and they accept the free movement of personnel. And that's why Theresa May's decision was clear. She would not accept the Norwegian or the Swiss way, but her choice is Canada, a free trade association. But you should take into consideration that it took the European Union and Canada nearly 10 years to negotiate and to implement CETA, the free trade association between the both. And so we'll see what happens. This is a cliff edge. Yeah, so Theresa May's decision is made. Let me address some of the perhaps most important forthcoming questions. First of all, today, the economic law of the member states of the European Union, including the United Kingdom, is to 70% harmonized. This means 70% of the economic law of the United Kingdom is European law. And it's quite open, about whether it will remain in force or not. And it's the same with the decisions of the European Court of Justice. So if you have an idea, we talk about international treaties, we talk about round about 20,000 decisions, we talk about 70,000 laws, and this is all valid today in the United Kingdom. And it is open in the future whether it will be valid or not. There are some other questions. Perhaps most important for the United Kingdom is the so-called European passport for financial services. I will talk about this in more detail a little bit later. And last thing, English as official language of the European Union. After the Brexit, there are perhaps 3-4 million English-speaking people in the European Union. And we have round about 450 million inhabitants. Yeah, the European passport. For the city of London, quite important, and that's why 60% of the people of London voted for Remain. What does it mean? Why a European passport, banks can operate in the whole European Union and they need no license in the 27 member states. It's the same for European banks like Deutsche Bank, which can operate from Frankfurt into the United Kingdom and the other member states. And today, it is quite sure that there will be no more European passport for banks with their headquarters in London. So, a lot of US banks now are considering to move to cities like Dublin, Amsterdam, and Frankfurt. And give me the chance to speak about the core principle of European integration. This is an internal market. The internal market applies for goods, services, capital, and people. And people was quite important for the Brexit decision. And there is one leading decision of the European Court of Justice, the European High Court, the so-called Cassis de Dijon decision. And it's quite easy. It reads as follows. All goods which are lawfully produced or brought into free circulation in one member state can be imported or brought into circulation to all member states. And, for example, before this decision, it was not possible to sell beer from Belgium in Germany because of the so-called German purity law, Reinheitsgebot, a very old law. Or it was not allowed to sell German pasta, and we like pasta with egg, to sell German pasta in Italy because of the Italian pasta law. And this is the principle of the internal market. So, and this is a principle which is no longer accepted by the people of the United Kingdom, but because it applies not only for beer and pasta, it applies for people, for companies, and so on. It's the same principle. Yeah, I told you I'm a lawyer. That's why I would like to address some important legal issues. So first of all, we have to discuss whether the Brexit is a so-called force majeure event. This would mean that it would be a right to withdraw from contracts. Another important point, and I think this is interesting for other lawyers in the room, is a Brexit referendum a so-called MAC, material adverse change event? Yeah, might be. Termination. Is it a right to terminate for cause? What is the future of so-called territory clauses? Open. Another issue is European Union trademark law. There exists the so-called European Union trademark, and the question is now whether the protection of this European Union trademark will cease to extend to the UK territory after the Brexit. We actually see a run for registration of new IP rights in the United Kingdom, and we'll see what will be the future of trademark and a lot of other connected rights. For example, the European Union just introduced a new IP law, the so-called know-how law, or the know-how right, and this is quite new. There are a lot of other important points. I already talked about the European passport, which is really crucial for the City of London, but there are some other topics. The legal framework for the financial industry. Today, it is nearly totally harmonized, but I'm quite sure we will see in the future a tendency to liberalize the legal framework, and we'll see what this means. Another point is clearing. Everybody needs an allowance from the regulatory authority of the European Union if clearance takes place outside the European Union. The same is with outsourcing and, quite interesting, what is the future of the so-called LMA standard, Loan Market Association, which is comparable in the United States to the LSTA. Today, it is UK law and the LMA standard which dominates all finance contracts. We don't know what will be the future. But these are only some questions. Matt already spoke about the former Eastern European countries. From my point of view, it's quite interesting that two Anglo-Saxon thinkers published their books in 2004. Jeremy Rifkin, he's American, the European dream, and Mark Leonard, professor at the London School of Economics, why Europe will run the 21st century. What was the idea behind these books and the concept? It was after the reunification of Europe, the reunification which took place in 2004 with the accession of the former Soviet bloc countries into the European Union. And the idea was that in the future, much more countries, countries like Ukraine or countries like Tunisia, will seek European Union membership. And that's why they will adopt the principles of democracy, rule of law, and last but not least, free market economy. So the idea was that there exists really a European dream with no frontiers. And this may lead to the so-called onion or sun model. And this was the vision of Rifkin and Mark Leonard and some other thinkers. But now it is a vision of the European Union 27. It is thinkable that there exists several forms of integration. It is thinkable, and I hope this will happen, that some countries like France, Germany, Spain, decide to found the United States of Europe, or the United Nations of Europe. And this was the initial idea. It was the initial idea in 1946, when Winston Churchill, the former UK Prime Minister, spoke in Zurich about his vision of a European Union. He was a man who initiated this concept, this idea, in 1946, 1 year after the Second World War. So this might be a vision. Some countries may decide to integrate deeper at a real political union. Some may decide to be part of the Schengen or fiscal union or euro system. Some others have only access to the internal market, like Switzerland and Norway. And then we have the accession candidates and the potential accession candidates. And this might be an optimistic vision for a future European Union. Finally, allow me only some words about Frankfurt. I'm from Frankfurt, and as you all may know, Frankfurt is a comparatively small city. Frankfurt has only around about 700,000 inhabitants. London has 10 million, so it's really more or less a small city. It was an independent city-state until 1866, and it was the seat of round about 300 banks, including famous names like Rothschild and Bateman, which were founded in the city limits. And quite interesting for the states, in the 1860s, the Frankfurt Stock Exchange, Deutsche Börse, was the marketplace for United States, for union bonds, because the London Stock Exchange and the United Kingdom was in favor of the Confederate States of America, and that's why union bonds were only traded in Europe, in Frankfurt. Yeah, since 1949, due to a favorable decision of the United States and UK occupation forces, Frankfurt became the seat of the German Central Bank and 1998 the seat of the European Central Bank. And since 2010 it is the seat of the regulatory authority for insurance companies, and since 2014 it is the seat of the regulatory authority for the major European banks. So one can say it is a regulatory head or the center of the European Union. And it's the seat of all major German banks and of a lot of international banks. So people in Frankfurt think Frankfurt might be one of the winners of the Brexit. This is not for sure, but it may happen. We'll see. But one thing is for sure, people in Frankfurt are all sad about the Brexit outcome, and nobody believed in this. So I hope this gave you an overview of the German or Frankfurt perspective, and I think now it's time for a discussion. Thank you very much for your